please, and we're gonna be giving you some beautiful music tonight, so please enjoy.
Ningong ningamariwe.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. DVC and Principal of the College of Humanities, Professor Cheryl Porchita, the Dean of the School of Religion, Philosophy and Classics, Professor Yannis Smith, the Dean of Education, Professor Greg Kamwendo, our esteemed guest lecturer, Dr. Duman Lovu, esteemed guests, staff and students, and everyone who is here. Usually, lectures are events that happen once in a while, and they're exciting at the time when they are held, and then they're forgotten. Usually, scholars get excited on a particular research theme or findings that they've just made, that they feel that they would like to put into test, and sharing these with other academics and students. Then they organize a lecture and invite people to be part of the conversation. Sometimes visiting scholars come around and then those interested in his or her work organize a lecture in order to engage him or her. Some inaugural lectures and then those which are rituals of welcoming new arrivals in the prestigious selected club of the Proseforiate. Even those events, they come and go, and in fact, they get forgotten, even by those who are the key role players. However, there are a few lectures that graduate from being an event to becoming an institution. Such lectures grow and end up having a life of their own. They are hosted from one year to another without fail. They have broad long-term goals for which they are organized. As the years go by, they are hosted with the aim of developing and nourishing the minds of not only the academic community, but even of ordinary people, and their own contributions to the development of new knowledge, dissemination of it thereafter, social transformation, social cohesion, and development. Such lectures are usually organized by a small group of dedicated people. They develop their own body of disciples who look forward to attending every year with their own, every year without fail. Such a lecture becomes an institution and a source of knowledge. The J.L. Dube is one of those lectures that have become an institution. The College of Humanities has been hosting these lectures for over a decade. In fact, today's lecture is the 13th one. Indeed, the lecture has become an institution, and every year we are always looking forward to the opportunity to drink from our own wells, as Gustavo Gutierrez once said. Today, too, we are here to keep this tradition alive. Thanks to the DVC and Dr. Ndlovu and the organizers who have made this lecture possible. And from one year to another, we will continue to drink from this well and celebrate our own leaders and our own heritage. Now, I cannot say welcome, because somebody who really invited you is the one who's going to welcome you. These were just my words of introducing the lecture that we have, the John Dube Lecture, which this year is hosted as the 13th one. Now, we're going to have the Deputy Vice Chancellor and Head of the College of Humanities, Professor Cheryl Porchita, who is going to welcome you, and those of you who received the invitations would remember that they came from her office, and as the head of our college, she is the one who has invited us, and it is indeed a pleasure to ask her to come forward to welcome you, and after that she will be followed by Professor Mulesane, as you can see in the program, who is going to give us some snippets about the lecture, and then the music group is going to give us another item. Then I'll come forward after that. Thank you. Welcome, Professor Porchita.
Thank you, Professor Khumalo. Let me share a little secret with you. When Professor Khumalo is the director of ceremonies and I need to do the welcome, I cut my welcome by like 300 words because I know he does part of the keynote, the welcome, the program directing, and the thank you. So thank you for that. I again do what I usually do when you and I are on the same platform. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome and acknowledge the presence of a number of guests here with us. A number of you have RSVP'd, and I do know that certain people have RSVP'd, but they might not be here this evening, but I would acknowledge you anyway. The first, I would like to acknowledge the presence and the support of the MSc of Arts and Culture. I would also like to acknowledge Reverend Sipho Mthethwa from the Office of the Premier. I would also like to acknowledge Mr. Bongani Khumalo from the Royal House of Utrecht, members of the Dube and Madema families, members of the executive of UKZN, deans, Professor Kamwendo, and a special warm welcome to Professor Fikile Mazibuko, who was the Deputy Vice Chancellor and Head of College before me. It can't be that bad of a place if you come and visit us. So welcome and thank you for being here. I also want to take this opportunity to welcome, and I see he's there, he's one of my students, and he was a student, a master student of mine at the University of Pretoria, and I do know that you might now be in government, so I see you here and I waved to you when you came in, so I would like to acknowledge that. It's nice to see how people are moving between spaces. And let me just also go back and to say, I would like to say a special thank you to Professor Kamwendo, who's the dean and the head of school of this village that we, village that of the School of Education that we often refer to as the village. And I'd like to thank you for hosting this lecture at this venue this evening. I'd also like to acknowledge Professor Molitsani, who is the Dube Chair in Rural Education, and she will talk with you a bit later. Of course, I acknowledge Dr. Duma Dlovu, who is our esteemed guest speaker here this evening, and I want to say a few words about your contribution near the end of my welcome. To give you a bit of background, just to add to what Professor Khumalo has said, this annual lecture is hosted jointly by the School of Education and the School of Religion, Philosophy and Classics. And we acknowledge Professor Yanni Smit, who is over here, and he is the Dean and Head of School of Religion, Philosophy and Classics. And this means that one year the lecture is held in Pietermaritzburg, where the Dean of Religion, Philosophy and Classics is based, and then the alternate year, it's here at Edgewood. This is the third year that I've had the honor to open the lecture, and it's now a teenager in the sense that it's 13 years old. And 2 years ago, we made history when the lecture was translated into Zulu, and we have that facility here this evening as well. My thinking is that if we are serious about access to education, then the access of language is important as a tool and a facilitator for transformation, and it needs to be engaged with. We have a forward-thinking policy on language, and I believe that we need to put our policies into practice, and that's why we are committed to making this lecture available in English and in Zulu. I want to again remind you, if you don't know, for people that have walked in a bit late, that Professor Molitsani, who's here with us this evening, that she holds the Dube Chair in Rural Education, and I acknowledge your contribution, and as I said, you will address us shortly. As DVC of this college, this is one of the events that I'm actually very happy to support, both intellectually and financially. The lecture provides us, I believe, with an opportunity to reflect on the life of John Dube, and equally important for us it's for us to use this space in imagining what his response and thoughts would be in relation to current day higher education. One of the lessons we take from Dr. Dube is the importance of collaborations and partnerships with persons and organizations, both locally and abroad. We also take lessons in relation to the importance of making education accessible to those who do not have the opportunity of access. Recently, I wrote a public piece on the role of his partner and first wife, Nokutela Madima Dube, and it is important that her role be acknowledged, but I will talk more to the College of Humanities plans to acknowledge her in another space. I don't have that space this evening. In my opinion, there are crucial questions that we all need to engage with in relation to education, and specifically rural education in Southern Africa. We need to engage with the issues of access, as I've said, the issue of transformation, and what I am quite comfortable labeling the decolonization project of education. How are we ensuring that the doors of learning are open to all? How are we ensuring that we are producing and graduating learners and scholars who are critical thinkers and committed to making our country a place where policies and practices talk to each other? UKZN is the first university that has a transformation policy, and we attempt to do excellence and transformation simultaneously. We are growing the next generation of black academics, and one of the innovative initiatives that I want to share with you this evening has been for us to support from January next year a number of African black scholars who we have identified in the third year honors and masters and who have obtained cum laude and summa cum laude. We've offered them scholarships and we've said to them that we would cover their studies until they complete their PhDs. Then they would be automatically ensured employment with us. If we are serious about growing the next generation of black academics, we need to intervene and not only talk policy. I don't believe it takes 20 years to grow a professor from a PhD. I believe that this is one of the many UKZN initiatives that John Dube and Nokutela Madima Dube would be very supportive of. However, my role is merely to welcome you and not to provide a keynote speech. I was sitting next to Dr. Duma Dlovu, and he received an honorary doctorate from the University of Venda, so I have every right to address him as Dr. Dlovu. And Dr. Dlovu said to me that he has stage fright. I don't think you should have in front of your audience here. Dr. Dlovu, in your work, I know that you have written what you like. You have written what South Africa likes, and I believe that your keynote this evening will be talking to what we as an audience like. And I acknowledge the writing and the liking and the thinking to Steve Bantu Biko, who wrote what he liked. And if we look at the transformation and the decolonization project that students in this country is taking the lead in at this point in time, it's very interesting that they've turned to the work and the thinking of the Black Consciousness Movement. I also acknowledge Steve Bantu Biko here this evening because on the 12th of September, which is 2 days from now, we know that that was the day that he had died in South Africa. So Dr. Dlovu, our esteemed keynote speaker, we thank you for honoring us here this evening and honoring the memory of Dr. Dube by delivering this 13th annual lecture, which is acknowledging the work of the Dube Foundation. Thanks very much.
Good evening, everybody. Now I have stage fright. He has stage fright. Now I have a major stage fright. My job tonight is to just give you an overview of this lecture that's going to be delivered tonight. Our DVC, Professor Cheryl Potgieter, has already told you a little bit about the lecture and its history. But suffice to say that as part of the research and community engagement project, among other activities at UKZN, the various entities of the university focus on developing and disseminating knowledge through seminars and public lectures such as this one. The annual John Langalibalele Dube Memorial Lecture is the College of Humanities' contribution to such a project. Historically, the lecture had been hosted by the then School of Religion and Theology, I think it was called, on the Peter Maritzburg campus since 2003. With the establishment of the John Langalibalele Dube Chair in Rural Education, which I currently hold proudly, the School of Religion, Philosophy and Classics, and the School of Education have collaborated in alternating and organizing the hosting of the lecture on the Peter Maritzburg and the Edgewood campus, respectively. My colleagues and I, and they are sitting in the audience, are fortunate to have the support and leadership, as we have heard, of our DVC and head of the College of Humanities, Professor Potgieter, and our two deans, Professor Smith and Professor Kamwendo. As you heard, the lecture has been in existence since 2003, but tonight I want to just give you a glimpse into the history of the lecture over the past only 5 years as follows. In 2010, the title of the lecture was The Nature of Opposition Politics in South Africa, and it was delivered by Dr. Mvume Dandala. In 2011, the title was The Cowboy Turned Renegade Missionary, and it was delivered by Professor Sherif Keita. In 2012, the title was John Dube's Challenge to the Humanities and Education in the 21st Century, and it was delivered by the then Minister of Arts and Culture, Mr. Paul Mashatile. 2013, the title was IsiZulu Language as an Asset in Development of an African Intellect in Institutions of Higher Education, and it was delivered by Professor Vivio Mkhize. Last year, 2014, the title was Writing Women, Gendering History, What Would It Mean to Look at the 20th Anniversary of South Africa's Democracy from the Perspective of Nokutela Dube, and it was delivered by Dr. Gcina Mhlophe. Tonight's lecture is titled Reconscientizing South African Communities Towards Self-Reliance and Self-Respect, A Ghost Dance with John Langalibalele Dube and Steve Bantu Biko. A Ghost Dance is a Native American ceremony for the regeneration of the earth and subsequently the restoration of the earth's caretakers to their former life of bliss. In conceptualizing this year's theme, my colleagues and I decided to focus on a theme that would introduce dialogue and debate into how we might address the various challenges facing our country, and oh Lord, are they many. From high rates of unemployment and related poverty to the high crime rates, including violent rapes against women and children, and the xenophobic attacks against foreign nationals, especially those from other African countries, and the apparent reliance on and our disappointment in government service delivery. As South Africans, we find ourselves at a crossroads. unless things change drastically, and they change fast, our country is facing a very bleak future. Thus, this year we look to the scholarship and wisdom of the two South African thinkers whose philosophy of self-acceptance, self-help, and self-reliance informed their work in black communities during the colonial and apartheid periods, respectively. As we approach the 40th anniversary of Steve Biko's violent death at the hands of the apartheid police in 1977, and we reflect on Dube's legacy, we pause tonight in a sort of a ghost dance to ponder the questions. What would Biko and Dube say to each other and to us about the state of South Africa in 2015? We invite you to sit back and enjoy this tonight's lecture. Thank you.
The next tune we're gonna do is one of what I call South African standards. This is one of Mama Africa's tunes that he recorded in 1960 at the Webster Hall in New York, and the name of the song is called Jikele Maweni.
I'm a queen, 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 Hamba, oh, oh dear, Hamba bo.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Honorable guests, staff, students, ladies and gentlemen, it is a great honor for me to introduce to you Dr. Duma Ndlovu. You have a brief CV that have been printed in the program for you. I'm just going to highlight one or two or three items from there. Dr. Ndlovu is a South African writer and producer whose career has spanned 3 decades in the creative arts. That says a lot, 3 decades. Graduate of Hunter's College in New York, he cut his teeth in the literary world with his theatrical contributions, concentrating largely on writing plays with a social message. Plays with a social message. So that is important to note. This was inspired by the fact that he came of age during the turbulent years when agitation propaganda theater was the order of the day. He was hugely influenced by the theater of Gibson Kente and the teaching of Stephen Bantu Biko, and made it his challenge to fuse the work of these two giants into his literature and dramatic work. And I think that is very important to note, especially as we look forward to your lecture tonight. He has to his credit a list of plays and musicals, including Bergville Stories, The Game, The Ritual, The Door, The Journey, Memeza, a musical on the life of pop queen Brenda Fassie, and The Photograph. He is currently working on a play, I Say What I Like, a play about a fictitious meeting between Dr. Nelson Mandela and Stephen Biko when the latter visits Mandela on Robben Island. His collection of South African plays, Voza Africa, was published in New York by George Braziller Publisher in 1987 and is currently working on another anthology of South African theater that includes interviews with some of the luminaries of the theater. And I think that would be an anthology that we would really love to see, and we look forward to see that. He's also done very important work with the two soapies, Muvangu and Uzalu. Mr. Ndlovu's dramas have always spoken of the experience of the marginalized and the underdog. And through his writings, he has sought to inspire and challenge. He has to his credit a large body of work that has made the artistic fraternity the more richer. In May 2011, the University of Venda conferred upon him an honorary PhD in English. Dr. Ndlovu, we invite you to come and address us now on the topic, Reconscientizing South African Communities to Self-Reliance and Self-Respect, a Ghost Dance with John Langalibalele Dube and Stephen Bantu Biko.
Thank you. Ngiyabonga. Academia is intimidating. That's what I was trying to say, Professor. Ningakhohlwa ukuthi mina ngiphumelele emakhaya eBergville phansi kwezintaba zokhahlamba. Angifundile. So when Oliswa called me and asked me, Oguti, they want to know if I have a visual presentation or something like that, I was like, Bebenga Shongani. Our impression of academia is these people in big gowns and funny looking hats and lots of papers, not visual presentations. I said, hey, Bengzo Kichima. Zikhangisa ngiphethe ama video ngapha drums and trumpets and do what I'm used to do. Mina ngumuntu oyiginci neikesh. So when you give us an idea, we go to town with that idea. If you say boy meets girl, oh my goodness. We see pictures. Boy cannot just meet girl. No, that's not drama. That's real life. And as we all know, real life is boring. If real life was not boring, I would not have 12 million people watching my programs every day from Monday to Wednesday. So, guti abantu behlele endlini sitting with each other, husbands, wives, families, rather than talk to each other, they watch our drama. Who wants real life when you can have uxhaphashe? So thina bantu beyikesh sifuna idrama sonke isikhathi, but academia on the other hand, you don't see them merging anywhere, you know. Academia is so intimidating. I grew up in Soweto. This is very funny because I grew up in the 70s, as has already been mentioned. Now, just to obtain a BA was massive. So think about this, especially those of you who are under 40. There were only three black universities in the country. There were only three black universities in the country, Fort Hare, Ongoye, and Tefloop. That's it. So for the millions of black people to be able to get to go to one of those universities was massive. You talk about lack of money and blah, blah, blah. But there was this metric thing that was waiting for you, you know. So once you get to go to university and get this degree, you come back, you are mightily proud. Now, how important was degrees and education? Now, and this is Soweto, I don't know how many of you can picture Soweto. Soweto, we like fun. We like, we like to do things crazily. So there's a birthday party. Let's say a birthday party of a child, of a seven-year-old. Then you invite your friends and stuff like that. If you are a graduate, your friends have to wear their gowns. So he has this birthday party of a seven-year-old, and there are these people with gowns and stuff. And you're saying to yourself, okay, who's graduating? But no, it's a birthday party of a child. That's how intimidating academia is. So, you know, when we grew up, having a degree was, my goodness, you wanted to have a degree so you can go to that party. Because it simply meant if you didn't have a degree, you can't go to a birthday party of a seven-year-old. So, Professor Potgieter, academia is intimidating. And those are the pictures I had as I grew up. And of course, I had wanted to get a degree. And of course, my father had died when I was 13. And of course, I had to go to the golf course and be a caddy to check us and be pick up bags and stuff like that. I had wanted a degree so bad because I wanted to wear that gown and go to those parties. So ngiyabona nje la university, they could see that I'm in early stage fright, and they wanted to make me feel at ease. They brought iginci, and it has helped. The music was good. Let's give them a big hand. But yeah, I do spend a significant amount of my time teaching acting. I have dedicated every Thursday of my life to teach acting, because in South Africa, we do not have professional acting classes of any kind except in universities. And most of our children who want to be on TV are not in university. So I do deal with Abo Stanislavski and Abo Grotowski, and I do try to teach young people with the stage fright is a state of mind. So yes, I did bring a state of mind today, because academia is intimidating. Program Director, Professor Simangaliso Khumalo. Deputy Vice Chancellor and Head of College of Humanities, Professor Cheryl Potgieter. Professor Johannes Smith, Dean of and Head of the School of Religion, who has just done this beautiful introduction. Professor Gregory Kamwendo, Dean and Head of School of Education, Professor Lebohile Moletsane, who is the head of the John Langalibalele Dube Rural Education, and Professor Figile Mazibugo, former Vice Chancellor of the University of the of KwaZulu-Natal, and who is also, Zululand, Professor University of Zululand, who's also a good friend. Esteemed guests, friends, brothers, sisters, comrades, and camaradas, and all protocol observed. There is something significant about comparing and contrasting both the influence and impact that John Langalibalele Dube and Stephen Bantu Bonke Biko had on South African society, even though they lived almost 75 years apart from each other. In 2 days' time, as has been mentioned, it will be 38 years since Biko was brutally murdered in a Pretoria prison after he had been dragged, chained, and naked like an animal more than 1,000 kilometers from Port Elizabeth to Pretoria. The way he was killed indicated something that in isiZulu we call isihluku, an overwhelming sense of meanness that we cannot find words to describe. In killing Biko, his torturers were bent on trying to extinguish a fire. That had been started in 1901 when a group of learned black scholars decided to stand up and fight against an evil system that was fast encroaching, fast turning them into indentured servants in their own land, a system that was fast trying to wipe their own image of self and replacing it with a docile, shuffling lot who would in later years listen to the white man without questioning, a lot that would only dance to the master's tune, but a lot that would also engage in acts of helping to contain other natives. John Langalibalele Dube was part of the mix. In fact, was in the leadership of that crusade to stop the British from completely taking over the land and subjugating its indigenous people to a life of permanent servitude. Ngiyaxolisa ngikhohlwe ukubingelela futhi umndeni kamafukuzela. Ngiyambona umfowethu lapho langa ukhona, and we say siyanibingelela. But in brutally killing Biko, what is this fire that the authorities were trying to extinguish more than 30 years after the death of Dube? What is this threat or fear that they were trying to contain? Have we as a people sat down and tried to interrogate these questions? Have we given a thought to how brutal the system became in later years and why? I believe that in examining this thesis, we'll be able to locate a narrative that links the activities of early revolutionaries, such as John Dube in particular, who was also known as Mafukuzela of Africa, and the activists of his generations on the one hand, and the actions and activities of Biko and his generation on the other. Two sets of people who lived on opposite sides of a century and who operated and did what they did under different and yet similar circumstances. I am further convinced that in examining their lives and times, we will find an eerily common thread that links these two giants of African philosophy. And furthermore, I suspect that we will be forced to draw conclusions that say to us, the work of these two colossal figures was meant to interlink and weave a story that carried the hopes of the oppressed masses until the attainment of freedom and beyond. Having said that, we are forced to examine those linkages and study the similarities. And when we do, we are also forced to do further research, research that has to, by definition, explain to us some of the things that brought them together, what defined the similarities, and what, if any, were the connections that created a link between the work done in the early 1900s, when Dube was the man of the moment, and the work done in the 70s, when Biko's name was synonymous with freedom, when some of us came of age. In trying to link the work of these two philosophers, we attempted at this stage to talk about reincarnations, amadlozi, karma, and other fancy stories as Africans are wont to do. But we will resist that for now, Professor Khumalo, because this paper is not about that. And we will restrict our study to the imperatives that we have been given. We'll try instead to allude and suggest that there exist possibilities, that even as hard as it was, the young people of the 70s had thoroughly researched the work of early revolutionaries and were acutely aware of what Dube had tried to do a few decades before them. We will argue that the similarities in scope to some of the efforts, especially around self-reliance and self-determination, warrants that there must be a connectedness. Otherwise, the coincidences are just too great. Stephen Biko spent his formative years in Natal, Durban specifically, where he studied both medicine and law at different intervals, of course. And if I remember very well, he dropped out from both of them. Life has these ironies. And he must have had access to places that like the Killie Campbell and other libraries and other sources of information that would have laid at his fingertips massive information on John Dewey's numerous activities. But then I digress. Please do venture to stop me. I was meant to be a preacher. So I do tend to be long-winded in my approach to things and subjects and conversations, especially when I'm having fun. This to me is fun. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been asked to come and present a paper on reconscientizing South African communities towards self-reliance and self-respect. A ghost dance with Langalibalele Dube and Stephen Bantu Biko, the topic is called. How do you even begin to dance with these two stalwarts without going back into their history to examine how they came to be who they were? How do you examine their principles of self-reliance and self-determination without developing an argument as to their placement in history and in society? Allow me therefore to indulge myself and draw parallels and linkages, and in so doing, begin a process that I strongly believe should have been initiated a long time ago, to connect the dots between the John Dube's struggles for liberation and Biko's own contribution to the quest for freedom. It is quite telling that the two were as much freedom fighters as they were community activists. And maybe one has to explain here, because maybe we get confused. You see, there are revolutionaries who just want to pick up guns and go and shoot other people and get their freedom. But there are other people who are concerned about the fabric of society and how we make it from day to day. And those are the people who then concentrate on issues, as the professor was mentioning, of rapes and murdering and victimizing women, because the fabric of society is very sensitive. Sometimes you don't kill a people by shooting them down. You kill a people by messing with the fabric of society. These two individuals, interestingly, focused and concerned themselves with the fabric of society. And this, I think, we need to pay particular attention to, because a freedom fighter, a picture of a freedom fighter is a picture of a person with a gun who goes into exile, who goes into training, and yet we neglect to look at society, to look at family. Dube founded an educational institution that is not only still around and alive to this date, but has been a pillar of strength and has stood as a mighty stature in providing quality education to black students for more than 100 years. Interestingly, it was even more prominent in the late 60s and the 70s when Biko's teachings were at their most popular. There's a very interesting connectedness to that. Ohlange was very much a community-based organization that was created of a need to fill a void. Having been educated in and introduced to the wonders of education in the United States, Dube wanted to spread the gospel of education. He would later say that he could see that the encroachment of white domination was encircling the black race, and that one of the few ways out, if not the only way out, was through education. He envisaged a world where the black masses would be educated and therefore be able to stand toe to toe with the white man. He had traveled several times to the United States, where matters were not that much better. The United States had just come out of slavery a few years before. In fact, when Dube landed in the United States for the first time in 1887, at the age of 16, slavery had been abolished a mere 18 years before in 1865, which meant that it was quite risky for him to travel on a ship, nohal. Now, here's somebody. The United States has just abolished slavery, and thousands, millions of black people have been taken to the United States to slavery. 18 years it's abolished, he gets into a ship and goes to America. That was brave. That was brave. He saw how black Americans who were oppressed as well used education to further themselves, to better their lot, and decided that he wanted to do the same in his native South Africa. He was greatly inspired by the black American abolitionist Booker T. Washington, and to a large extent, he was modeled as a South African version of Booker T. In 1904, he was to found a newspaper, Ilanga laseNatali, which, interestingly, was a leap of faith to, or a big testament that Ohlange, among other institutions of the time, had done their work to produce a reading culture a mere 3 years after its founding. Now, here's somebody who builds a school in 1901. I'm assuming in a sea of what is generally called illiteracy. He builds a school in 1901, and people are getting into classroom for the first time. And in 1904, he starts a newspaper, which means that these people now can read and buy the newspaper. It is either a leap of faith or the man was just amazing. So who were the readership? 3 years after the building of Ohlange, it's kind of scary. If you translate it in today's society, into today's society, it means that, and I'm not familiar with the new educational system, it means that you sell newspapers to third graders. And these are some of the things that we have not looked at in examining the life of this great human being. And of course, when some of us have not traveled overseas that many times, Uguya just states, you know, it get on the ship and go to America and come back, get on the ship and go to London. This is in the 1900s. It was amazing. Both Ilanga laseNatali, the newspaper, and Ohlange, the institution, still stand today as pillars, as clear examples of what Dube set out to do, to fight racial discrimination and subjugation with institutions that would advance his people. At the darkest hour, when politicians and revolutionaries were arrested and thrown behind bars, these institutions stood and continued on the ideals of the founder. And there is nowhere they could have been taken down because of the politics of the time. These two institutions were shining examples of Dube's efforts of restoring human dignity. And according to his fellow men, the self-respect that was quietly being eaten away by laws upon laws that the white settlers were introducing. Quietly, the white masters were introducing laws and measures that were stripping away, were stripping the black man of his self-worth. Dube asserted that in order to reverse that, blacks had to be educated and had to rely on their own resource to push back the frontiers of the hate and subjugation. He rolled up his sleeves and proved that it was doable. The massive success, even during those early days, was only evidenced by the growing feeling of worth, which then translated immediately to a hunger for freedom. The Bambata Rebellion of 1906 was one of those shining examples of Dube's success in conscientizing society. Dube's ideals of self-reliance and of a self-reliant and self-sustaining society never for once faltered, nor took a holiday, nor went on for a walk. In his quest to change people's lives, he founded institutions that have been in existence more than 100 years. If that is not revolutionary, I don't know what is. Ohlange is still standing tall. Ilanga laseNatali is still a dominant force in the KZN literature and print media circles. And then, 7 years later, along came a young man in his 20s with wild ideas and a vision to better his people's lives. Biko's sudden appearance in 1967 at the age of 21 at a NUSAS conference in Grahamstown and his ideals of a black-only organization are heavily reminiscent of Dube's emergence, also at a very young age as well, on the horizon in his quest for an education and a dream to free his people. We will later draw parallels to the material conditions in the country on both periods. Dube emerging after the battles of Isandlwana and Ulundi, and Biko's emergence after the Rivonia trial of the early 60s and the massive defiance campaigns and the resultant political lull of the early 60s. Biko too emerged at a time when the black man needed to be restored. His dignity having been eroded through a variety of laws that further declared him a third great citizen in his own country. He needed someone to come and restore his pride and heal the wounds. The past laws were playing havoc with people's lives, and the influx control laws were making people's lives a living hell. Families were being divided every day as men were sent hundreds of miles away to sell their labor, while wives and children stayed behind to try and find themselves in arid conditions and most times to devastating effects. Thousands of homes were broken and people were left destitute and without hope. After Mandela and his lot were sentenced to life terms for speaking out against these evil laws, the black men had every reason to stand with a bent back. It was just too much. We couldn't take it anymore. But we're also too bent out of shape to fight back. We will not go to the story that we all know of a political lull and a void in the country created by the arrest and detention of the Mandelas of this world. Stories have been recounted over and over again how the arrest and imprisonment of the Rivonia group left a void, how the political temperature in the country took a dive because black people shied away. Biko and his black consciousness cadres appeared in the horizon and addressed the void. Apart from creating SASO, which reignited political activity in the country, they also set out to create and found programs that would survive the political struggle. Programs whose sole intention would be to uplift the black people and give them a reason to live. This Biko did by going back to the very communities and asking them to come together and contribute to the emancipation of their own selves. That is how the Zanempilo group of companies was formed, and today's Zanempilo health facilities stand tall as direct result of Biko's Zanempilo clinic. There was something humanizing in the efforts of the young people of the Black Consciousness generation. There was something restorative in their action, and there was something that said to the community, I am because you are. These actions went a long way to fuse layers of dignity back into the communities and gave people more hope that things will be better one day. Biko's vision was clear, and he was perhaps Black Consciousness's most articulate spokesperson. But once again, behind the myriad of programs that they initiated, one finds a common thread with some of the program of with some of the work done by the Dubes of the early 1900s, and the intention is quite clear: to restore the dignity of the black man. In one interview, Stephen Biko explains the rationale behind the formation of the black community programs. Open quote. Essentially, to answer the problem that the black man is a defeated being who finds it very difficult to lift himself up by his bootstraps. He is alienated. He is made to live all the time concerned with matters of existence, concerned with tomorrow. Now, we felt that we must attempt to defeat and break this kind of attitude and instill once more a sense of dignity within the black man. So what we did was to design various types of programs, present this to the black community with an obvious illustration that these are done by the black people for the sole purpose of uplifting the black community. We believed that we teach people by example. Close quotes. Even more interesting is the fact that Biko and his disciples founded a number of newspapers, journals, and magazines, which they used for the sole purpose of communicating with the masses. And of course, we know Mafukuzela's commitment to newspapers and publishing. The introduction of religion to the black masses was and always has been thought to be a way of the European settlers to ease onto the African communities and then steal their land. It is telling that Dube and his generation decided to embrace religion, and in embracing religion, they did not of necessity acquiesce to the white man's attempt to subjugate them. There's a striking similarity between Dube's and Biko's approach to the whole question of religion and theology. Just like Dube, as Dube not only accepted religion, but was ordained as a pastor as well, Biko also welcomed religion, but insisted on developing a brand of religion and theology that would further enhance the narrative of freedom for black people. It is worth noting that many of Biko's disciples became or were already on their way to being priests and pastors. the likes of Pani Pichana, Reverend and Bishop Mlungisi Mpumlwana, Bishop Manasi Buthelezi. It is also worth noting that after the South African Church started taking a pointed view of the liberation struggle, and struggle icons were born out of the then church leaders, Bishop Tutu got his stripes in the days of black consciousness, and names like Alan Busak, Bishop Njongonkulu Ndungane, all of them got their moments to shine in the days when black theology was espoused by the likes of Biko. I just want to paint a picture here. During the political lull, and for those of us who were around then, we did not see any political activity. Suddenly, black consciousness comes into the picture, and suddenly all these religious leaders sprung out of nowhere. Without trying to offend anybody, most of us did not know all the names, fancy names that you see today, the bishops, the archbishops. We didn't until black consciousness. And suddenly they sprang up from all over the place. And not only that, and they started leading marches, and they started being at the forefront, because black consciousness forced the religion to look inside and look at how religion had been used to subjugate the black man. And therefore, black theology started growing, and we started seeing a different texture of religion. Ngiyabonga kakhulu. Yabona ke le la ngiqhamuka khona uma unginika amanzi anezinto ngaphakathi ngizothi ufakile la ngaphakathi. Ngiphumele eBergville mina. Uhlamvu liyaziwa. Le la ngiqhamuka khona izulu silithengisa ngo-20 cent. So uma ufuna izulu nje 20 cent. Professor, I'm trying to translate into English in my mind. We sell lightning for 20 cents. The question of language. Somebody called me desperate. They were speaking in Sixhosa, asking for 250 because ufuna ukuthenga umbani. And I'm saying to myself, ufuna ukuthenga umbani? Uzokwenzani ngumbani? And it evoked memories of a Bergville with Ibo. So we talk, and then after the transaction, I say to another friend of mine, Ibo, somebody just called me, utufunu kuthenga umbani, but no, umbani is closer for electricity. I was like, oh, okay. So these are the constant layers, small and numerous, that add texture to black society, to the quality of life, the essence of being. These are the elements that make up what we collectively in black tradition call ubuntu, the principle of I am because you are. That Dube chose this path to restore the dignity of black people, especially a few years after the ultimate defeat of King Cetshwayo's army, Empini Yasondini, the Battle of Ulundi in 1870, post the defeat of the British by the Zulu army, Esandlwan, the year before, shows the mettle of the mind that is thrust in the middle of a people who are in turmoil. Again, you know, after Impi Yasesandlwan, those of you who have studied that period, today, Ulundi kuthiwa Ondini olumahlikihliki because of that experience, because of the destruction and the death and the devastation that was left, where people had to pick up their pieces in 1871 and try and make sense of the things that were happening. 7 years later, Dube goes overseas, and in 1901, he starts programs that are meant to bring back the fabric of this society, a society defeated, a society that needed healing. It is interesting that he doesn't take up guns to go and fight. And of course, for some of us as revolutionaries, we sometimes are critical of people who preach peace without looking at what drives them to preach peace. Imagine after people have been defeated in the manner that they were defeated at Empini so soon, then you come and say, let's take up guns and go and fight. I mean, Lawuma Khehla Zokutshela ukuthi uyasangana mfana. Dube understood
very clearly what society needed then. Society needed repairing. Society needed a rebuild. Society needed the fragments to be brought together. And he did. And if I check my mathematics very well, he was not yet 30. Amazing. When we look around us and see 30-year-olds, scary. Ungahleki mfowethu. Umfowethu ama dreadlocks, kusho ukuthi isitimela sesikushiyile. Biko was 21, and I saw you calculating when I said 21. I saw you doing your math. So one in a million. I mean, only one of those people are born in a long period of time. As mentioned before, Biko operated under similar circumstances. After the heavy losses of black leadership after the Rivonia trial, as we have said already, Biko came back and emerged and came with programs to put the pieces together, and is credited with reviving the political consciousness after that. Should we dance already? Is it time to dance? We should at least take our hats off for these two individuals and acknowledge that they both came with unique instruments to fight subjugation. Unique in the sense that it was not easy for the white man to fight against someone who starts a school. How do you arrest a person for building a school? It was impossible to fight against somebody who educates young black minds, because how do you separate the school's intention to teach black people to read and write and its ability to restore human dignity? And that's where they could try, they even banned people. They were like saying, there's something in this bigger person, because there was something beyond what he was doing. You couldn't arrest him because he didn't have guns. You couldn't arrest him. He was not leading marches. I always tell people, Biko has never arrested a group of 2,000 people. He couldn't. But there was something he was doing. But what is it, and how do you stop it? You ban him, and uprisings come up all over the place. How do you arrest someone for starting a clinic to help young children affected by kwashiorkor and malnutrition in black communities? How do you overtly define that as terrorism? And yet, how do you stop a community from standing up for self when there are pillars of strength in those very communities? Pillars of strength that provide various communities with heroes and sheroes who look like them and say to them, be proud of who you are. Are we dancing yet? Professor Potgieter talks about an initiative to produce PhDs. God, we need that. God knows we need to start producing young black people who speak with a twang and quote Plato and Socrates and Dube and Biko. We need to produce those. Those are the efforts of Biko and of Dube to go into our communities and turn the tide around by doing things that are unexpected or things that the enemy is not going to be able to stop. The subject of this lecture is quite interesting, Babu Dube. Actually quite amazing. I love music. I listen to music all the time, and I'm from that fraternity. That's why umakuthiwa jikele maweni ndiya hamba nami, I want to start dancing. And ngifune nokukikiza. You see now, this is an academic institution. Angizwanga anybody lilizela la beculwa la. People are like, bravo, bravo. Niyabora. Nifunde kakhulu, as my grandmother would tell you. As my grandmother would tell you, nizohlanya, nifunde kakhulu. In fact, Professor Khumalo gave me a choice, when do I want to address the lecture? And of course, it had to be during the week. So I had to be mindful of 8:30, because I have to be home at 8:30. So I said, oh no, Thursday, uzalo aloko. So they said the lecture will be over at 8:30. I can run and go and watch Umubango. At least I won't miss Lokuzana. I listen to a lot of music. So when I saw the topic, it reminded me that not too long ago, a renowned black American soul singer, Luther Vandross, wrote an emotional song before he died. The song was called Dance with My Father. The image of a black man dancing with his son, or father even, is a damn powerful one that evokes strong sentiments as it eventually supports a strong picture of a baton being handed over from one generation to the other. The symbol, and most Zulu men, Professor Kamwendo in here will understand, and I'm sure now you'll tell us of a similar picture in your society. The symbol of a spear or indugu gababa, the father's stick being handed to the firstborn son at the graveyard when the father is being buried. Those are powerful, evocative symbols that we as a black society only understand too well. Hence, this is the picture that the title evoked in my mind. Hence, I declared at the beginning that this is fun. I hope that you are also having fun with me. Dance with me as I dance with these two great and distinguished individuals. This title, and I was listening, Professor Muletsane, as you were recounting all the other lectures, and I thought I was very lucky to be given this title. Ngikhathele ukukhuluma ngamagatar neigesh. So ngiyabonga that I could come and talk about this powerful, and it is powerful. And I hope that the young people who are doing their honors and their masters are going to take this up as a subject of study, because within this topic, there are so many layers of subtopics that we can follow. There are so many, and I didn't know. We then go back to where we started, the death in detention of Stephen Biko and the brutality with which he was killed. We already stated earlier that in killing Biko, the white regime thought that they would extinguish a fire and put an end to it. Unfortunately for them, it was not to be. Biko's death instead ignited a spark that the white minority regime had not seen nor anticipated. The whole country burst into flames of anger and a resentment that was hard to fathom by those who had killed Biko. In fact, they were perplexed. They could not understand the reaction to Biko's death. Hence, they issued one contradicting statement after another. At first, he had died of a hunger strike. And then the then Minister of Justice, Mr. Jimmy Kruger, announced to a gathering of Afrikaners a few days later that Biko's death left him cold. Then the truth started unraveling, and a gruesome act started coming to the surface. Unya, isihluku of unparalleled proportions. And one could not help but ask the question, why? They had tried to put up the fires since the early 1900s, and they couldn't. When the ANC Youth League was born in 1946, and the subsequent bus boycotts of Alexandra in 1946, and the Afrikaners coming to power in 1948, and the massive laws that were introduced, Bantu education laws, the banning of the political organization, the Communist Party, in 1950, 1954, Verwoerd saying black people should be given a different education, all of those measures to try and put the black men down, and nothing was working. 1955, massive defiance campaigns. 1961, 62, 63, Rivonia trials and brutality, and nothing worked. And then 76 explodes into flames. Kanti, what is wrong with these people? So you see, the machinery that was put in place for us when we were detained in the 70s was different than what was happening before. Because here was a desperate animal who was trying to hold on to power, but things were not working. And the acts of brutality became even worse. When you hear what used to happen at the border as they were trying to wade off communists, you hear stories of cruelty and isihluku and unya. Hence, for us, the killing of Biko represented the brutality of the system. Young people being thrown from 10th floor of John Foster Square, young people being killed, and eventually the escalation, because when you then see what de Kock and his Flag Plus Brigade did, when they killed Biko, we did not think it could get any worse. Then Flag Plus came. Then people killed our people and stood beside and buying meat. And they were not satisfied with killing them. I mean, what's worse than killing somebody? So they killed people and they were not satisfied. They were like, no, this is not enough. What else can we do? As they were laughing, drinking beer and eating meat, then they said, bring those explosives. Then they brought explosives. Then they tied human beings to explosives and they blew them to smithereens and there was nothing left. Now, you can kill a black person, they will forgive you. But every black person ufuna ukungcwaba ithambo lakhe. Now, if you want to go beyond brutality, kill a person and then there is no evidence that that human being walked the earth. There is no bone left. This is a Zulu. We are saying, I want to bury my bone. I want closure. I want a place where I can go and say, this is where you are. The brutality escalated because Biko and Dube and their disciples came with a way to restore the dignity of this black person. If dignity had not been periodically restored, all of us would be crazy. We would be mad beyond imagination. You need to look at countries that had been devastated by war. And you come to a sense that, like South Africa, we really have never had wars, as much as we were struggling. You go to Frelimo in the 70s. You go to Smith's Rhodesia. We see the faces of our brothers as they come in here with that devastation and some of the pain that they bring. Then you understand what war does to human beings. When you want to drive a human being crazy, take away his dignity. And that's why Dube and Biko were such God-given people, because they then came into our society and put those layers and textures and said, it will be okay. You know, sometimes, particularly for us as men, we look down upon hugs. You know, hugs, and you wonder why our women love to hug. But that's a restoration of your humanness, to bring you back closer to the heartbeat, to remind you of who you are. As you are laying in the bosom and the heartbeat goes push, 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 you are reminded of where you come from. And that's what Biko and Dube did to us. They brought back that humanity. They embraced us, they hugged us, and they said it was going to be okay. That is why also, after those initiatives, black people come out fighting even more and say that we will be victorious. Soweto had erupted in flames in 1976 because black people came up and said, freedom now. Now, when you look at the texture on the faces of the kids of 1976, you had never seen anything like that. For those of us who've lived across the generations, I mean, I still laugh when I look at Dr. Mandela's pictures during the Rivonia trials and them in the dock. You know, they're having fun and you're like saying, ay, that's not how we fight. 76, we came with another level because our humanity had been restored, because we had been given hope, and in our eyes, we could see freedom in the horizon. We then dismissed the older people and said, old man, you don't know what you're doing. We are going to do it better than you. And when you look at from 76 to 86, you saw an escalation of that determination. And with the escalation of the determination, you saw the escalation of the brutality. Hence, I speak about Flag Plus in the 80s, particularly 86, 87, 88. And then, of course, 1990, the monster was brought to its knees. Wherever he was, the first president of the ANC was smiling in his grave. And of course, that symbolic act of Mandela going to vote Ohlange, revoking those memories of one of the people who started it all. the textures and the layers and the restoration of the human dignity of the black man are some of the things that have ignited this fire. Dube's philosophy and methodology was based on giving worth to the human being by giving him education and raising him to the same level as those that sought to denigrate him and put him down. As we have said, he gave us things that we could hold on to. Today, Professor Khumalo, as you drive to a building, Mhlanga, and there's the boom gate and a security guy sitting there, ubaba nje ongamdelela. As he comes up to you, the first thing he does, he puts on the side, ilanga lasenatal, and comes to you and says, sawubona ngakusiza. John Langa libalele Dube being effective 100 years later. Amazing. Amazing. Connect this, because our problem is that we don't connect the dots. Connect this. Sometimes we are accused of putting ubuZulu bethu a little bit higher than anybody else. And Zuluness is Africanness, so we should not separate the two. But connect this. In the whole country, the only language that has a newspaper is isiZulu. Okay, no, I'm wrong. The only language that has 3 newspapers. Okay, I'm wrong. The only language that has a daily newspaper. Now, Isolezwe, which is probably the fastest growing newspaper, was started to challenge Ilanga. And rivalry gives growth. So, I mean, I don't see that as negativity. So, there are 3 newspapers let me stop. Sunday Times, for a while, published in isiZulu. City Press wanted to follow suit. How can you not connect that to John Langa Libalele Dube? It's because we failed to make the connections. And it is when we fail to make the connections that we do not grow and we do not progress. Because then your victories and your progress stands in a silo to his victory and his progress, and stands in a silo to it. If we can connect the dots and understand that the work that was done is connected. Because the enemy that we fight against is not a fool. They is not lying low. That is why black consciousness was fought so much. That's why agents were sent into our communities, first of all, to discredit black consciousness, to say, this is not the it. We should have said, here comes a reincarnation of Umafukuzela. Here is Biko, who's doing exactly the same things that Dube did, so that we could support him. And the successes would have been much greater. Agents were planted in our marches. Connect the dots, please. So the agents, and you can listen to the TRCs and all those things and you'll get evidence of this. They would be the first ones when you are protesting, they will go and burn a school. Hello? Today, 21 years after the dawn of democracy, young people in the townships who march against the government because of dissatisfaction over service delivery, maybe the lack of water in their community, vent their anger by burning buildings and schools and libraries. Am I missing something? There's no water. Yeah, there's no water. Yeah, burn the library. Yeah, there's no water. Then library? Because our enemies are trying to wipe away the work that John Langa Libalele did. We therefore come to the conclusion as we go towards finalizing this discussion that young people today, in fact society as a whole, needs to go back and examine the work done by both Dube and Biko and the solid foundation that their work provided and glean from it lessons that would revitalize us as a people. This English. That would revitalize us as a people. We're in fact saying we need to go back to our own communities and start self-help institutions and go back to teaching the young to respect themselves, respect their own communities. And in that way, they will learn to appreciate the society in general. It becomes hard to destroy something that you yourself has built. Students need to give themselves time to research the work and philosophies of both Dube and Biko with a view to benchmark their own future. We need to study. We need to do research. We need to connect the dots. The work that lies ahead for us is mammoth. We have to ask questions and go back and compare and contrast, even though we might not find all the answers, but we believe that this study, this conversation, this analysis should prompt others to look at some of the issues we have raised and take them on and do further research because we believe this subject needs further interrogation. Few people have ignited the quest for freedom in the manner that Dube did, and yet fewer have achieved the economic status that he did during the times that he lived. No one person has built and worked on making his people's lives better like he did. For too long, African revolutionaries have failed to see the connectedness of those who fought to free their people, especially those who lived in different time zones. Langalibalele Dube, called Mafukuzela, is an important case study in our society and indeed in the history of our struggle for emancipation because he represents the first group of freedom fighters. In fact, he stands alone in the podium as perhaps the first South African revolutionary. Therefore, it becomes important for us to use him as a benchmark or to use him to benchmark the history of our struggle. He is the face of the early revolutionary. In his method or methods, we will be able to see and determine how early black South African revolutionaries approached the quest and the question of freedom. I can't get over this leaf. Ukhona umfowethu la ngakhulela khona owayethanda amagwinya. They asked him why he loves fat cake so much. Then he tells the story of a woman who wanted to give him ubheka mina ngedwa. Wawufaka emagwinyeni. There's this herb called, what is it in English? Look at me and only me. Don't look at other people. So ubheka mina ngedwa wasebenza wagcina ethanda amagwinya. So we asked what happened to the woman. And he said, she's not around today, so. We said we will stay away from what appears to others as superstition or superstitious. We vowed to stay away from talking about amadlozi nabaphansi. But we could not help noticing that John Langalibalele Dube died on the 11th of February, 1946, on his 75th birthday, which, by the way, happens to be the day he was born. Which happens, by the way, to be the day Nelson Mandela was released from prison. I haven't said my piece yet about amadlozi in a superstition, nezulu. He died on the 11th of February, 1946, and Biko was born 10 months later on December 18th of the same year. Reincarnation? 10 months, passing the baton. I prefer to see it as Dube, the father, dancing with Biko, the son he never saw. I also wish I could dance with my father. Siyabonga. Instructions very well in Zuhlala.
Kacheni, boya benyati, obusonga obusombuluka,
inkomo ezadla ekhaya ngokweswela belusi. Zaze zaluswa intombazana uDumazile. Mpongo singelwayo ngonyama nina bakwasihlangwe sihle. Siyabonga kakhulu. Thank you very much. I am going to ask my colleague, Professor Roderick Hewitt, to come and lead the question and answer session.
There were a number of times as I listened where I felt as if I was going through some kind of ecstasy and almost shouted, "Jah Rastafari," but I had to keep myself quiet, you know, because I thought, oh, that may not be appropriate in this setting. But I'm returning to my decency in saying, however, that as I listened, as a student of Marcus Garvey, I felt as if I was listening to the voice of Garvey all over again. And with all the different quotes from these two giants, I want us to move into the question and answer phase of this presentation. I want to recall the words of Garvey. He says, "If you haven't confidence in self, you are twice defeated." Yeah, that's what he said. And you're twice defeated in the race of life. But with confidence, you have already won before you have started. That's what Garvey said. And when you consider that Garvey died in 1940, just about close to the death of Dubé and the baton of these giants. And now, I believe we have had supper. I'm making all of that comments to say that I don't think there's going to be need for any long questioning. We have already heard 8:30 is the second coming. And by making that point, you will forgive me if I misbehave and ask you, okay, that's one point, we need to move on. And maybe if you don't like that, well, you just don't like that. We're going to take questions now. We'll take two questions here, two questions there, two questions there. And after that, I will not return. Because by then, time is up. Okay. Two questions, please. And I want to see your hand, and I'll invite you to speak. Please.
Thank you. I didn't know you'd start with me. Thank you very much for the reminding us about the past. But I'm just trying to find out something which is very, I don't know how to put it, about the education of today, if there can be a change going back to the lecture of Dubé. What needs to be done in your view, whereby you'll find the child said has passed at 30%, further where sometimes there were others at school, one comes late, he wants to know, did you get the results? I said, yes. Did you pass? Their friends said, yes, I've passed. Oh, it means I also passed. I said, yes, you all passed. And I see this has become a very dangerous situation, and I think here in this hall, when I raise this issue, it can be easily answered by the people at school, teachers, lecturers, to see what needs to be done in education to change that. Go back to what Steve and John Dubé has built in their lives for education. Thank you.
Right, we'll take another question or comment. Please, go ahead.
Thank you.
from your own understanding, Mr. Ndlovu, is our current education on the track of promoting self-reliance and self-respect? Mm. If it does, how come do we have Imali Yeqolo? If it does not, what is the motive behind? Thank you.
Okay, let's take on board our response, and then we move on.
Thank you. Of course, you don't get bombs when you're speaking, but you get the bombs in the forms of questions. So I'm not sure if I was ready for that. The first question is an interesting one, and I have a controversial answer for it. I don't think there's anything wrong with our education. Now, speaking in an institution like this, talking about education, saying this, I know it's going to be controversial. When we go back to the works and the teachings of Ubiko, and that's the subject for today's paper, we've got to fix the fabric of society. Now, who are these people who make the laws? Who are these people who go to parliament and vote? They come from families. If everyone left their family where the fabric was strong, then the decisions that they make would make sense to everybody. We need to go back and restructure. What has happened into our society today, and it also goes into your question as well, is that the male figure has disappeared from the family for whatever reason, and this is not why we're here. So we no longer have fathers. Part of the reason we are to blame, we also can blame apartheid, we are correct. We can also blame women who drive their men out, and you hear all kinds of talks. You can blame anything, you can blame everybody. I'm saying blame men, blame men, but the result is that there are no longer male figures within the home. So the child who's supposed to hear two voices is only hearing one voice that acts on the place of two voices. And that is anormal. We need to go back and repair that fabric of society. The education today, when you look at the Department of Education, they are responding to abject conditions that are in our society. Life revolves, life moves. We can't stay in one place. We went to school, we were going to Fombani, Nabo Fombani, there are different circumstances today. I think we need to go back into the home and repair. What you will see, Mr. Nkosi, happening is that those kids that come from homes that have a structure, they will go far in life, while the majority of society disintegrates. So the lesson is then we need to go back to our homes, because it means that you still can build something from your home. Is education today providing for self-reliance, imali yeqolo nazo zonke lezi? Same answer, we are reacting to material conditions. You know, indaba yemali yeqolo iyathusa. For us as the conservative fathers, we criticize it. I'm one of those people who criticize it, because I lived in the United States for a long time, and I understand that you can create a welfare state ungaboni. Now, however, we have taken the negative and they've overridden the positive. There are families in rural homes where we all come from, where the child and the family survives on that grant, however much it is. There are people who are living because of poverty. So what the government is doing, it is providing social benefits to fight poverty. It is an anomaly, it is abnormal. But when you look at our unemployment and you look at people that work and then you look at what AIDS did to ravage our society, it is somewhere, somehow, it does patch and balance. But of course, when you go to Soweto, Gwamashu, Elamonte, Kukuletu, you see urban society, you see young girls abusing that, and you see other kids who are not smart, wanting to have four kids so that they can have more money. You're looking at the negative aspects of that thingy, when we have to go back to our communities and fix. Now, this is what Biko and Dube wanted to address. They wanted forums where people can go back into being a united community. We're no longer we can't agree on anything now. Go to a street forum, a street meeting, we can't agree on any issue. Go to a community forum and raise an issue, we can't agree. And yet we grew up in the 60s when Gogna Matoto Muzi named Fengwane, and when people, everybody agreed with everybody. So we need to go back and restructure that.
Thank you very much. As we move to the next section, I want to emphasize we want to hear all voices, and that means male, female voices. So let's see if we can get some other comments on this side. By the way, if you don't put up your hand, I will ask you if you don't want to ask questions.
Good evening. I thank you for the lecture. Thank you for reminding us of our fathers. I get worried sometimes when I hear people say that South Africa has the best constitution. South Africa has the best policies, but we're failing to implement. And I ask myself the question of, is it lack of consciousness of what we need to do, or is it still the continuation of the oppression that was? Why is it that when a black man is in charge of himself, the black man suffers more, to an extent that the black man thinks it's better to destroy the little that he has built to acquire one thing that they need at that time? What is our problem? Is it really us, or there is something else in us? Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's a concern, but also it's a question. Do we really need to go back? What is wrong with recreating new families, bringing back the values? Because you keep on saying we need to go back to the families. And there are no families. They've been destroyed. What is wrong with recreating? The university, can it be a new family and adjust and bring back? So do we really need to go back? Thank you.
By the way, Professor Kamwendo, as I sit here listening to your voice, I salivate. I keep asking myself, where can I use it? Now, if you are not in academia, I would say you are wasting your talent, Professor. But I try to discourage people to go into acting. But I just want you to know that as I keep listening to your voice, I'm like, Konje, a drama, a radio, a Rastafarian band. And thank you for quoting Mosiah Marcus Garvey. Yeah. And thank God for Bob Marley and reggae and that music and a country that just took a collective responsibility to communicate struggle and history. Nothing else. I went into Google the other day, but to then watch a documentary, Haile Selassie documentary, and I don't want to get into controversies, but I just said to myself, Jamaica just decided that we're not going to do nothing with our talent but communicate the black man's story. And if we had done that in South Africa, if we had a way of doing that, because we do it in spasms and too little, too far apart. I've never heard a song on Dube, on John Langalibalele Dube, not one. There's a couple of songs on Steve Biko, Abusi Mpiwe Dana, and a few other people. But as a people, if we could communicate those things, we could go somewhere. Very interesting questions. Baba, I have these regular meetings with my kids. I talk to them about laws, policies, and I usually say to them that there's no constitution that's going to help me to run a family. The Constitution is not going to raise my kids for me. My kids are going to be raised by me in my home, collectively with my wife and them. And I've said to them that you are your own leaders. Let's run this government together. Let's come with a set of agreements and decide this is what we're going to do. So that when we go outside, we meet the laws and the policies, we have an opinion, but an opinion that we can then comment on, but we have a way of life that is inside the home. What is happening in our society today, precisely to the point that you speak of, is we have abrogated our responsibility at every level. We work on somebody's agenda. Now, the newspapers are not selling today. City Press, about 4 or 5 years ago, used to sell 250,000 copies. Today, it sells 90,000 copies. And yet, on Sunday, we wake up and listen to City Press telling us about President Jacob Zuma. So decide what you want to think of Jacob Zuma, but not because of what City Press tells you. Because when you look at white liberal media, they have decided on what their agenda is. And they steadfastly stay on that agenda regardless of what the facts say. They then articulate and repeat the same thing, and we believe it. They've given it to us, and we take it and we run with it. We've abrogated our responsibility to make our own decisions on any matter. On any matter. Now, I'm going to give you just one example, and it's a controversial one again because of the newspapers. Thuli Madonsela says it cost $246 million to upgrade Zuma's house. Police Minister Nathi Nhleko goes and does the research. He comes back with factual figures, 50 million rands. Since his findings, the newspapers are continuing with 246 million rands. Then Nathi Nhleko says 135 million rands built 21 homes more than a kilometer away from Zuma's house. 135 million. That's fact. Go and look for it anywhere. So it costs 50 million, 20 million in professional fees. Every newspaper today says it costs 246 million rands to upgrade Zuma's. I'm not taking sides. I'm just saying to you, that's what the newspapers have decided to do. And we go with their narrative because we no longer think for ourselves. So any statistics they give us, we will take it and use it as fact because we no longer think for us. That's on the agenda part. On the second part, because leadership in communities was based on merit. John Dube was a minister, was a pastor, he did everything because he was a leader. He was chosen on merit. Now listen to this. In 1912, a group of esteemed and very educated human beings, including Dr. Pixliga Seme, met in Bloemfontein. And when they had to elect a president, they said, no, there's nobody among us who's fit to be a president. That person is overseas. They elected him when he was not there. What does that mean? It means that you outati noma ubani umenze I leader. Now, the things that you are talking about and the protests and everything else, whenever gune riot, the newspaper and the media goes to Lomfana, who looks like Julius Malem, and ask him for a comment. Now, he's the one who's going to articulate what the community says. But is that what the community says? So he's the person also going to say, Shisa. So because of the void in leadership that we have allowed, the non-leaders have taken the positions up front. We are refusing to volunteer ourselves. Our society is led by Abo Julius Malema. And it's not by default, it's because we are allowing them to do that. His election into the youth league, we supported it. I probably am one of the people who supported it as well. By the time you realize that, is this what the black community needs or is this what society needs? It was too late. We had created a narrative around him. Now, I'm talking about your community, wherever you come from. And when there's a service delivery protest, look at the people who speak for you. You don't know them. He's the guy who got Peminya Upe last week. Ungolile, mongam telang amanzi, ang Afrika out. And then he speaks for the community.
So there's nothing wrong with us, it's just that we're refusing to take up our positions. So I lived in the United States, as I've said, and the feminism movement in the United States was very strong. So you are careful of what you said every time. So I guess I'm back in South Africa, I tend to be a little bit reckless a little bit. So when we say let's go back to family values, we're not saying that let's go back and sizzling or ludala because we're no longer there. But there's an interesting point that you raise that I think we need to talk about as a society, as a people. And it then also makes me sound like I'm a Christian or I'm biblical. I ask a simple question. And I'm asking a question in a group of academicians and to say that I'm spanning a debate. Can you create a family without the family that we know? And I'm saying, let's not get into a chauvinistic debate or whatever. Let's look at a practical society. Now, I said something before about a child hearing only one voice. I seriously believe that in creating nature, the creator created a particular balance. There are certain voices that you need to hear at certain times in your lives. In my research and study, I've come to the conclusion that there are certain things that God doesn't want us to know about the child. That's why you don't remember anything that happened before the age of 2. You don't. There's nothing you remember when you were 18 months, 12 months. Few people will say they do, but I doubt. Because life is structured in a particular way, and there are certain things that need to happen. So maybe one is saying, let's acknowledge what the traditional family structure is and try and support it as much as we can. I think we'll be making a fundamental mistake if we can say there are no men in our society, so let's forget about the men. I think we'll be making a mistake. I think we need to move ahead as a society that we are and try and retain as much structure that was given to us as we can. And where we can't, then try to see how we do things. Then you'll say, what am I saying about same-sex couples? I'm saying that as a community, we have accommodated same-sex couples and we should accommodate them. And when they come and say, this is how we want to raise our family structure, we should give them as much support as they need. I do not think that needs to be our modus. I don't think that we should say everybody should go that direction. So you hear me very well. I'm saying we should acknowledge that there are people like that, but we should also say it is not the mainstream of what we try to do. So we should continue to encourage our children to get married if they want to. We should continue encouraging family structures as we know them and continue to go back and tap on that family structure so that moving forward, we are referencing what we were given, what has worked successfully so much. But we also understand that it's not all the time that we're going to be able to accommodate that. And then don't go out of our way to kill people because they are not like us. If we can do that, I think that's the going back that I'm talking about. I love the fact that I'm a father. There's nothing that I enjoy. I mean, writing dramas for me is nothing. The best thing to ever happen to me was God entrusting me with 6 young people, beautiful young people to raise. I am having fun. I'm having the best relationship with my children than I have with anybody else. And when I say this, I get into trouble. But my relationship with my children, because it's my God-given right to raise them and make them better human beings, I am having so much fun, and that's the only reason I don't want to die.
I think the last comment, we have triggered lots of questions. But guess what? If you think you're going to lead me astray by accommodating more than 2 more hands, all the other questions beyond 2 more hands will come after we have left.
Okay. I am an African American from America, here in South Africa, teaching English in a rural community. I want to first thank you for allowing us to be here this evening. And secondly, I want to ask the question, how do you think internalized oppression allows or prevents South Africans from being critical thinkers or moving outside of the box in which sometimes they find themselves.
Okay, next question.
Good evening. Thank you so much, Babuka Jenny, for a wonderful lecture. And I will leave this room a changed person because of what you said. And what I'm taking with me, especially, is that you said Biko and Dube made sure, or they made sure that a black man had to be educated. Given that the education system in South Africa today is criticized left, right, and center, but we do acknowledge that DBE, or the Department of Basic Education, makes very good policies, but they're failing to implement. But what I normally say to people is that the department has done so much, the government has done so much, but we shouldn't be asking what DBE or the Department of Education can do for us, but what we can do using what they have done for us. So the question is, what is the role of the society in ensuring that a black person continues to be educated?
Thank you, and I think that's the same question, really. I think that's the same question. One of the reasons I decided to dedicate every Thursday of my time to teach acting is because I want to produce thinkers. We don't have thinkers, and I think that all of us have to go back and do what we can to encourage young people to learn so that they could be thinkers. I think that's critical. I think we need to look at society the same way, and I really am not sure, but I think the same way that Dube looked at society and said, we've just come out of a war. Coming out of a war, you have a lot of orphans, you have a lot of destitute people, you have a lot of men who don't have wives and wives who have lost their children and stuff like that. And that's chaos. There's no chaos that is beyond that, because everybody's thinking about, how do I get back into the groove of things? And it becomes difficult for you to say, go to school. So we then have to design programs to fix that fabric of society. And I keep going back to that, because I'm arguing that it is only because they went back and repaired society that things began to be different. Somebody starting a self-help institution or a soup kitchen somewhere, and people's dignity being restored. Somebody starting a sewing school that looks like it is not important, but a woman who is abused comes in and finds a collective comfort with sharing stories with other people and coming out there, the dignity being restored. You've got to restore human beings for them to go back into society to be better human beings. We are dealing with broken people. We are dealing with people who have been beaten down. We are dealing with men who look at their children and see sex objects. We have to stop and say, how? When did it happen? I spoke about war-torn societies before. We have infused everybody into one melting pot with people who've had massive trauma because of war, and people who are functional. I read stories about Battalion 32. I read books about Battalion 32, where the white government went to Angola to recruit the 32 Battalion and asked them to come to South Africa to spread AIDS, and told them to go and look for accommodation in communities and a room for 100 rand, uhlale roomini, but make sure that every high school child ulala naye. That, you know, and you're not saying people did, but you don't blame the Angolan brothers, but the South African government had a concerted effort to do something. And once it was part of our psyche, started a rumor that says if you sleep with two-year-old kids, it cures AIDS. And some of us were around when those things were happening. Those are propaganda things that were put out there. And of course, AIDS was scary then. And of course, if you had AIDS, then you'd want to try something and your humanity is gone. Those things only happen when you've taken the humanity out of society. So I am arguing that in black communities all over the world, by the way, where are you from?
I'm from Ohio.
From Ohio. That's where he went to school, by the way. So I've been to Cleveland. I lived in Harlem. You go to any, you go to Chicago Southside. Any collective place where there's black people, the humanity has been taken away and we begin to do things that are strange. But that's because somebody made a critical effort to break us down. So it cannot be automatic to return the fabric of life. It can't be. It needs 1,000 Bigos and 1,000 Dubes going back to the communities to sacrifice and turn the people's psyche around. It's not going to be easy. It is not going to be easy whatsoever. Then there's this element, Siswami, Uti, Gune Department of Education, Nati. What has also happened, as broken as we are, Sazi Gakulu. Yo, South Africans know too much when they don't know. So I say to my classes, don't know too much before you know. So everyone wants to tell the government how to do things. Shut up and be led. Shut up. If this was not an academia, I would have used another word in between shut and up. You don't know nothing about running a country. Shut up and do your part. Sazi kakulu. We have so much to say. We are like soccer. That's why I don't like soccer. Everybody's a coach. So we need to elect a government like they would do in Nicaragua or Grenada or Cuba, you know, elect a government Cuba. We need to entrust, and they got a lot of things right though. We need to entrust the government with the responsibility of running the country. We need to go to our communities and fix our communities. Here's a person whose child has got 4 babies before the age of 21, wants to tell the president how to run the country. Sazi, kakulu, shut up. You don't know nothing. Do your part in trying to recreate society. Now, if you can hear whether it's the Minister of Education or the President explaining the 30% pact, it makes sense if you listen. It makes so much sense. Sazi kakulu. Yeah, tina, pasa 50%. You're on a low 50% is an embarrassment. When there are people who are passing at 19%, you are being done a favor. What's kakulu? What pass standard 4 at 50%? We're talking about metric right now. So, on the agenda, my brother, on this question of the agenda and other people's agenda, and I'm very serious, we need to go back to each other and say, if you make a comment about anything, what qualifies you to make that comment, number one? Number two, how much are you contributing to the erosion of the quality of life of our people? Because we do that every day. We want to kill people for things that we do not know. There's so many people who've been accused of things and we come, you don't read. So now there are reports. Government does reports. The Marikana reports, about 600 pages. The Nkandla report, about 500 pages. Don't shut the fuck up unless you've read the whole report. Have you read the whole report? No, shut up. That's it. Why would there be a 600-page report? Why would somebody spend 72 million rands for a 600-page report for you to read one page? Hello? Because we are on somebody's agenda. Now, in closing, Professor, and this is so true of us, and it's painful. If you want to hide something from a black person, put it in a book. Now, white media has understood that so well about us. Yeah. They write everything they know you're not going to go and research. You're going to agree with everything that they say. For the first time, to the embarrassment of most of you in here, journalists are coming up to take responsibility for some of the nonsense that they've been doing for the last. They're coming up now to apologize because this one person that they've been trying to bring down is not going anywhere. So they're like, okay, so people are coming back, okay, we did this, we did that. But why in the first place were we in that space when we don't belong? when we don't read. So criticize me, but go and read the 2,000-page report that has been done about me, and then criticize me and say, on page 346, it says this, then I will respect you. Don't come and criticize me because they said I did something, and you, I'm like, back it up, and you can't back it up. We are a broken society. We need to repair. We need to come back. Ladies and gentlemen, I really, really want to thank you.
Well, let's put our hands together again and say thanks. I'm going to invite Professor Kamwendio to come forward to offer the vote of thanks. And thank you for tolerating me in harassing you.
Good evening. This is the true Professor Kamwendio. That was a fake one. I wish he was Professor Kamwendio and head of Dean and head of School of Education last week. That could have been a right time for him to be Kamwendio last week, right here on this campus. All protocols observed. I've been given a special assignment. I understand it's my KPA. The KPA is to offer a vote of thanks. Let me begin the KPA by acknowledging our very eloquent and inspiring speaker. He has given us a lot of intellectual food, and I was looking around at students and staff and saying, here we have research topics. So, if you don't publish from next week, topics have been given to you. If students are saying there's a drought of research topics, he is here. So, Doctor, we'd like to thank you so much for inspiring greatness, which is what we do at UKZN, inspiring greatness. Another round of applause for our We also applaud you for your creativity. I know I've been told that I should be brief in my speech because people would like to watch Muvango, including myself. But next time you come, please bring with you Gizara and Babalola. On the vote of thanks, I would like to proceed to acknowledge and thank members of the Dube family and the Ndima family for being here with us tonight. They have always been with us on this occasion. Thank you so much. You are part of our family. We'd like to thank Professor Potthita, who is the, I was about to say Dean, because I'm a Dean, who is the Deputy Vice Chancellor and Head of the College of Humanities for the support she has for this lecture series, and also for the financial injection that went into this ceremony. Without that financial injection, perhaps we wouldn't be here tonight. Thank you, Prof, for your support. I also want to thank, in her absence, Professor Renuka Vital, who is the DVC for Teaching and Learning. I'm well informed that this occasion is jointly hosted by the College of Humanities through the Schools of Education and RPC, and also the Language Development Office. I see Mr. Dr. Kumalo, Langa Kumalo there. Thank you so much. I would also want to thank my colleague, my comrade, Professor Jan Smith, who is the Dean of the School of Religion, Philosophy, and Classics, for the support and the encouragement, and also some commendable financial injection that went into this occasion tonight. The organizing committee deserves to be thanked. They had very sleepless nights. Fortunately, none of them went to hospital. They did a wonderful job. Thank you so much for what you've done, and we hope you do it again. History will repeat again next year. I would like to pay special tribute to our students, the musicians. Very often, we hear about students when there is toy toy, and the media are quick to talk about it, this on Facebook, all students are doing this, but we have wonderful musicians there. Can we give them a round of applause? You are really inspiring greatness. We are proud of you. And finally, I would like to thank all of you, staff, students, and people coming from outside the university. Without an audience, the guest speaker wouldn't have anybody bombarding him with questions. So I thank you so much. As I come to the end, I would like to thank the director of ceremony for directing so well. He did not misdirect it. And I would also want to thank Professor Hewitt for the job you've done well. You really behaved like a true headmaster in those days, strict. I would like to conclude the vote of thanks with a ritual. Normally, you don't give instructions to your boss, to your line manager, but I'm going to give instruction to my line manager and the guest of honor. So I would like, they don't know what they are going to do on stage, but I would like them to come. Please come. I'm giving instruction. Come on stage. The reason why I'm calling them on stage, I would like our Deputy Vice Chancellor to present a token of appreciation to our guest speaker.
I'd like to say Inkosi. I come from the Eastern Cape.
At this stage, I would like to hand you over to Professor Kumalo because I have to run for Muvango. Thank you so much.
Thank you, friends. Now we are going to sing the national anthem, and soon after that, there are refreshments that are going to be served in the hall. So we'll just go there and enjoy ourselves. So let's stand up, and those who are not vocally challenged can start it for us.
Nkosi sikeleli Afrika, aluphakanyiso phondo lwayo, izwa imithandazo yethu. Nkosi sikelela thina lusapho lwayo, murena buluka setshaba sa Yesu. Ufedi said in twali matwenye, usibuluke, usibuluke, si chabasa, Yesu, si chabasa, South Africa, South Africa, and if not far on Sechem, and if not far on Sechem, fand ich Grenzen an uns sounds the call to come together, and united we shall stand. Let us drift and strive for freedom in South Africa.